You would to Genesis chapter 12.
Chapter 12 here this morning. In Genesis chapter 12, we've reached a bit of an inflection point, if you will. Prior to this point, as we've moved throughout chapters 1 through 11, we've had kind of a very global scope in mind. Now, admittedly, in parts, that global scope is still kind of small. You think about Adam and Eve, you got two people. You think about who's coming off the ark, you don't have that many people. But nonetheless, there's been a focus that has been global. It's been worldwide. We've talked about how Adam and Eve were created. We've talked about how they're placed in a garden. We've talked about the fall. We've talked about their descendants and what their descendants have accomplished, which was not great. We see destruction. We see an earth that has been delivered from the flood, as it will, a family that has been delivered from the flood. And then you begin to see, as Mark's been going over the past couple weeks, you begin to see that now that flood is over, now that cataclysmic event has passed, we begin to see those nations begin to spread out, begin to kind of sprawl out on the face of the earth. But even still, the focus has been on everyone, right? We've covered Shem, we've covered Ham, we've covered Japheth. We've not left anyone out. We have seen that all of these sons are having sons, and their sons are having sons, and you can start to kind of trace that out the more if you want to. But you can see that this scope is global. Genesis chapter 12, we reach a different point. Genesis chapter 12, that focus begins to narrow. No longer are we concerned about everyone that's on the face of the earth. Now our focus is narrowed down to one man and his family and his descendants that come after him. It's a remarkable change. As we've looked at, and as we've gone through this series, and you've noticed, you know, foundations and faithfulness up every single week, as we reach that point in Genesis chapter 12, in my mind, there's kind of a mixture change that begins. You look at those first 11 chapters, and you're primarily focused on foundations, right? And there's faithfulness that's involved, there's no doubt. There's covenants that are being made. Those covenants are still impacting us. But the emphasis is on foundations, right? Establishing what this world looks like, establishing how this world works, establishing how God is dealing with mankind. As you move into chapter 12, and we move throughout the rest of the book, the mixture changes where now we're starting to get heavier on faithfulness. We're still establishing foundations. Don't think that we're not done with that. We'll establish some more here this morning. But the emphasis begins to change to more of the faithfulness of God to this family, the faithfulness of God to the descendants of Abraham. There are covenants that are going to be made, and there are covenants that are made with flawed individuals. Individuals who have failings, as we'll look at this morning. Individuals who are not exactly rock stars when it comes to righteousness, right? These individuals are making some awful choices, and yet the faithfulness of God persists. The faithfulness of God marches on. They continue to persist. They continue to exist because of the faithfulness of God. And so there's a change that we're beginning to observe this morning as we go into chapter 12, and it's this change towards this relationship that God is having with Abraham and with his descendants. As we look at this morning, I want to highlight particularly the faithfulness of God in this chapter. It is strong here this morning, and so that'll be our focus. Before we do that, let's start with a word of prayer, and then we'll dive in and see what's going on. Father, we thank you this morning for the opportunity to be here. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you this morning as we do it in song, as we do it with our prayers, as we do it with listening to the word, Father, and hearing what you have for us. In all of these ways, we worship you. In all of these ways, we declare that you are worthy of our attention. You are worthy of our praise. And as especially this morning, Father, as we look at this passage here in Genesis chapter 12, I pray that we are moved more in that direction. As we consider the kind of God that you are, as you reveal yourself to Abraham, as you provide for Abraham, as you choose Abraham, Father, an unlikely character, Father, it should take us to reflect on our own selves. It should take us to reflect on where we have come from It should focus us on your faithfulness to us despite our own failings. And so, Father, I pray this morning that this is happening. And so give us grace to see that. Give us grace to be at that point, to walk in that way. And Father, I pray that you'll give me just clarity of words and clarity of mind, Father, as we work through this. Give us grace that we can be edified. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me start reading here in Genesis chapter 12, and we'll jump in here. So Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. So you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. In you all the families of the earth will be blessed." So Abraham went forth as the Lord had said, spoken to him, and Lot went with him. Now Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abram took Sarah, his wife, and Lot, his nephew, and all their possessions which they had accumulated, and the persons which they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan. Thus they came to the land of Canaan. Abram passed through the land as far as the site of Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. Now the Canaanite was then in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your descendants I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him there. Then he proceeded from there to the mountain on the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord, and he called upon the name of the Lord. Abraham journeyed on, continuing toward the Negev. As we look here at this chapter and these first few verses, and we'll get to the rest of the verses towards the end here. As we look at these first few verses, we see a shift, a big change. We were introduced to Abram back in end of chapter 11 back there. And we noticed that Abram is of the line of Shem. And Mark did a good job setting that up for us last week, helping us to understand where this is going and what is going on here. God has appeared to Abram at least once at this point in time, from what we can tell here. The message, the promise that is being given there in chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, has either occurred in the land of Ur, in Ur, or it is appearing again here in Haran, or both. And so this is really kind of interesting to think about. When you look at Acts chapter 7, you look at Stephen's accounting of what is going on, Stephen makes it clear that God spoke to Abram in Ur, that is where this message goes on. I don't know as to what chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, is not a reiteration of a promise, because God seems to do this a lot with Abraham. As we look at Abram's life, God is appearing to Abram many, many times, and he is oftentimes coming with these same kind of promises, just kind of packaged in different formats. It's expanded upon, it's developed a little bit further, it becomes a covenant, a full-blown covenant, as we'll see in chapter 15. But these promises come to Abram over and over and over again. For our purposes, though, this is the first time that we've seen it. Whether for Abraham this is a revisiting of this promise for him as he's in Haran and having to make decisions, or whether this is simply the writer going back to what happened in Ur and simply telling us, by the way, this is what was said to Abram back there. For our purposes, this is the first time that we've seen these promises. And these promises are enormous. These promises for Abram are life-changing, right? And so I don't want to deal with them in depth, because we are going to be dealing with them a lot more. And chapter 15 is probably the better place to be looking at this in depth. But we would do a disservice if we didn't think a little bit about it this morning. So as we think about the promises that God is giving here in verses 1 through 3, there's five main elements that we see here in this passage. The first element that we see is land. Land. Chapter 12, verse 1, the Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you." Abram is being directed towards a land, and it's not a land that he is familiar with. This is not a land, I don't think, that Abram had spent time looking at on Google Maps trying to figure out, now where's a great place to go settle down? I'm thinking about going to New York City in September, and I can guarantee you I'm doing a lot of research. I've got my Yelp list of 100 greatest restaurants to go visit. I'm scouting things out. I already have maps for the transit system. I have a lot of things planned out for what is going on there. There is no indication that Abram is that person at this time, right? Abram is quite happy wherever it is that he's at, whether it's in Ur, where he grew up, where he's comfortable, where he's familiar, whether it's Haran, where his family has continued as they have been journeying through. Abram is content being where he's at. Canaan is not someplace that is just big on his list that he's got to make it there before he dies, right? Canaan is nothing to Abraham at this time, right? But God is making it something to Abram. God is telling him, I want you to leave everything that you know. I want you to leave your family. I want you to leave where you are comfortable at, and I want you to go somewhere else. Now here in verse 1, you simply see that he is going there, right? In verse 7, though, you see where this gets developed a little bit further. And the insinuation is, even in verse 1, that this was where we were headed. In verse 7, the Lord appeared to Abram, this is when he's at the oak at Morah, and said, to your descendants, I will give this land. Okay, and this is where we are headed. This will get developed. This will get further enhanced as we go along through Abram's life. But this is one of the core elements of the promise that God is making to Abram. He is giving him a land, right? And it's not the land that Abram is from. Abram needs to go from wherever it is he is right now to this land, which happens to be the land of Canaan. But this is where we are headed. We are headed towards a promise of land. The second element of this promise that we see here is that of a great nation. God is going to take Abram and he's going to turn him into a great nation. You see that in verse 2. I will make you a great nation. This is using wording that we have seen already in Genesis. As we have seen the nations kind of being described as being scattered around. We saw that expression, and Mark kind of highlighted it, the Gentiles. Right, the Gentiles, right? There is a great nation. There's a lot of these people, right? This is the wording that is being used for Abraham here. Abram is just a very small collective right here, right? You have Abram, you have Sarah, you see his brother Nahor, his brother Haran, you see Terah. You have a very small clan that is being described here. And God is saying that out of what appears to be a very small clan and what is a very small subset out of this clan, I'm going to turn you into a great nation that'll rival anything else that's on the face of the earth. Right? This is a tremendous promise. Abraham is going to multiply. His descendants are going to be great. And that is a promise that also will get developed as time goes on. The third promise that we see that God gives to Abram here is that he will be blessed. You see that in verse 2, and I will bless you. I will bless you. Hardly could anyone ask for anything more. Right. If the land was not great, if the great nation was not a great promise, this promise of I will bless you is enormous. It's almost like a blank check, isn't it? Right. And he's not even saying I'm going to bless you in these particular ways. He just says you will be blessed. Right. It is as wide open and as great as you could possibly hope for it to be here. Right. Abram is going to be blessed. He's going to prosper. And the insinuation is that this is going to continue with his descendants. You can imagine that, right? You think about them being a great nation. How could they become a great nation unless they are blessed, right? So there is an insinuation that this promise is not solely restricted to Abram, but he is going to be a beneficiary of that, and that is going to be passed on to his descendants as well. He is going to be blessed. That probably compounds then into the fourth element of this promise that we have here. And that is, I will make your name great. I will make your name great. A name meant a lot in this period of time. It signified something. It told you something about the person. And God is looking at Abram and saying, I am going to make your name great. Which, by implication, is going to mean that you are great. Right? You will be remembered as someone who is great. Some have taken this and pointed out that this is really something that is royal. In nature, that is regal in nature. Kings would have been said to have had a great name. This will be promised to David, in fact. In 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 9, God promises David this, I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make you a great name, like the names of the great men who are on the earth. It's a promise that comes to David. I am going to make your name great. You are going to be someone that is remembered. You are going to be someone that matters in history. They're going to be going down through their history and they're going to make sure they hit the name David, right? God is promising the same thing to Abram here. Abraham, in many ways, kind of prefigures what will probably come to David in that respect. And there is a sense in which Abram is royalty. his name will get changed. That will reflect that even more. But there is a sense in which Abram will live and will be thought of in a way that is royal. And you go through and you think about what we're going to see Abram do as time goes on, and the fact that he is able to deliver two cities from the clutches of five kings. If this man is not king-like, it's hard to imagine who else is, right? Abram is going to have a great name. He is going to be remembered and never going to be forgotten throughout history. The fifth promise is also significant and also one that continues to roll down even to us to this day. It is not enough for God simply to say to Abram, I will bless you. It's not enough simply to say that you will have a great name, that you will have a land, that your nation, that you will become a great nation. But Abraham is in turn going to become a blessing to others. That blessing that comes to him is reciprocated. It is reflected. And you see this end of verse 2. And so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you. And the ones who curse you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. This promise that comes to Abram indicates that Abram becomes a vehicle. Right, he is blessed. He has those blessings, but he becomes then a vehicle not only for his own blessings, but a vehicle for the blessings of others. And others experience blessing through him and in him and because of him. Now, there's a bit of a conditional element of that, isn't there, in this? So you look in verse 3, who do those blessings come to? Well, they come to those who bless you, right? There is a sense in which the blessings that Abraham is a vehicle for, the blessings in which Abraham reciprocates those back out, it comes to those who are in turn blessing Abraham, who have a good relationship with Abraham, who accord with Abraham in some respect. On the other hand, those who deride Abraham, those who curse Abraham, those who revile Abraham, they don't get that blessing, right? I will curse those who curse you. Right, so Abraham is a vehicle for those blessings, but it's not just that everyone gets blessed because of Abraham. There's a difference, right? There's a line that exists there. You either are blessing Abraham and in turn are being blessed, or you are reviling Abraham and you are in return being reviled. Right, you're either going to be on either one of those sides, but Abraham is going to be the vehicle by which those blessings come. And that final expression that we see there, in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. We see other passages in the New Testament that let us know very clearly this is Christ. Right? This is Christ. Everything that God is promising to Abram here, right? All of these promises that are coming to him, these promises include Abraham, but they go well beyond him. Right? They are meant to include his descendants. They are meant to include individuals like David. They are meant to extend all the way down to individuals such as Christ himself. Right? But these promises for us, they are in their seed form here. Right? This is what God has called Abram with. This is what God has promised to Abraham and said, this is what I want you to do. I want you to leave your land. I want you to leave your family. I want you to leave everyone that you know, and these are the promises that will await you. So these are heavy promises. These are big promises. These promises govern everything that you see, really, for the next all the rest of the chapters that you find in Genesis. It covers extensively what you run into as you run into Exodus, right? These promises become huge. And this is the first time that we see them coming to Abram and the first time that we begin to understand exactly what is going on here. So these are the promises of God. The second thing that we see is not only the promises of God, but we see the election of Abram. The election of Abraham. These promises come to Abram, but Abram is in kind of an odd spot when these promises come to him. In fact, Abraham, you could argue, is an unlikely character to be involved in any of this for any number of reasons. But there's three particular ones that I want to highlight for you this morning. As we look at the history of Abram, as we've looked there in chapter 11, verses 27 through 32, as we start to get a feel for Abram and for his father and for his family, there is no reference to any of them walking with God. There's no reference to it. And you think about what we have seen earlier, you think about what you saw before the flood, and you start to see this reference being made. You know, people are calling on the name of the Lord. This person walks with God. This person walks with God. As we come here to look at it, verses 27 through 32, you don't see any sense of that's going on, right? All you are simply told is that these individuals, they're of the line of Shem. That's it. That's all they really have going for them in some respects. And if you look in Joshua chapter 24, turn with me if you will there real quick. In Joshua chapter 24, that gets reflected by what Joshua will say about these fathers here. In Joshua chapter 24, Joshua is reciting for Israel their history. This is the end of Joshua's life. He's getting ready to pass off the scene. A new round of leadership is in order, and so Joshua is laying down a challenge. He is laying down charges for the children of Israel of what they need to do to be successful. And of course, we know that's going to come back to the law, right? It's going to have to come back to their obedience. It's going to have to come back to the worship of Jehovah. But as Joshua is recounting their history, in verse 2 of Joshua chapter 24, he says this. Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, from ancient times your fathers lived beyond the river, namely Terah, the father of Abram, and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. Then I took Abraham from beyond the river and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his descendants and gave him Isaac." Abram, Terah, Haran, Nahor, that entire clan are idolaters. They're not rightly related to God in any relationship, in any way, in any fashion. They have fallen into whatever has become the pattern of worship for that day. If you look at the names that are given to these individuals, they reflect that. They reflect the names of deities, of gods that would have been in this area. They indicate that they have named their children. Sarah is named after this. Milcah is named after this. These individuals are named in a way that reflects these are idolaters. Abram is an idolater, and yet God comes and he speaks to him and says, "I've got a promise for you." Does he deserve that? In no way does he deserve that. There's nothing that reflects that he deserves that whatsoever. Abraham deserves as much destruction as anyone else on the face of the earth would do at this time. And yet God looks at him and says, "Of all the people that I could come to on the face of the earth, I'm coming to Abram and I'm making a promise with him. And I'm calling him from this land that he is in, and I'm taking him somewhere else to another land so that he could be something great." Abram deserves this not a bit. Not a bit does he deserve this. And yet God is choosing him anyway. Not only is Abram an idolater, but Abram is not exactly an overly obedient individual. We've looked at other individuals, and again, I compare him with Noah. And you look at the endorsement that God gives to Noah, and the endorsement that God gives to Noah is that this is a righteous man. Now, obviously, we can't even start to ascribe that to Abram if he's an idolater, right? I mean, that's already off the table. But even as you begin to see the relationship that God has formed with Abram up until this point in time, Abram is struggling with really carrying out what is being said. If you look back in chapter 11 of Genesis, you notice that there's a transition that is taking place here. And we see in verse 31 of Genesis chapter 11, Terah took Abram his son and Lot the son of Haran his grandson and Sarah his daughter-in-law his son, Abram's wife, and they went together from Ur of the Chaldeans in order to enter the land of Canaan. And they went as far as Haran and settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years and Terah died in Haran. When you look at this account, There's really no reason given for why we start to have this exodus that's taking place here, right? They obviously lived in Ur of the Chaldeans. They're beginning to make their way to Haran with the end goal of making it their way to Canaan. But we don't have any indication of why they want to do this, right? What is it that makes them want to do this? It could be that this is part of that spreading abroad that is still going abroad after the Tower of Babel and everything that is going on there. Maybe it's something related to that. But it's just kind of odd. But then when you look at in Acts chapter 7, Stephen, again, he makes it clear that God spoke to Abram first in Ur. That's when he spoke to Abram. And so you start to take that piece of information, you begin to roll it back into Genesis chapter 11, and this exodus suddenly that Terah begins kind of starts to make sense, doesn't it? Abram must have received this vision, must have been told, "You're going to Canaan," and either was... And probably, I think, would have been told, "You're supposed to leave your family then," and he chooses not to. The New King James reflects this better. When you look at chapter 12 and verse 1, the Lord had said to Abraham. Had said to Abraham. In other words, this is a reflection of something that came before. right? Abram had been told, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you. He had been told that. But is he doing it? A little bit. He's left Ur, but has he left his father? Has he left the rest of his relatives? He's left maybe the larger clan, because Terah would have been a part of a larger clan, right? He's left them, so he's kind of been obedient, but he's never been completely obedient. And it's not until we find him here at Haran where you find him finally saying, all right, I'm leaving everyone now. But that's really only because Terah's died. And Haran has died. The only one left was Nahor, right? Everyone else is gone. It's only then that Abram decides that he's going to continue obeying everything that God has given to him at this point in time. And so again, I point out, does Abraham necessarily deserve this promise? Even if what is happening in chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, is coming to Abram a second time, right, just to give it to him one more time. By the way, this is what I'm supposed to say to you. This is what you're supposed to be doing. Abram doesn't deserve this, right? He's not even been obedient with what he's known up until this point in time. He's an idolater. There's nothing in this that indicates that Abram deserves this, and yet God is calling him anyway. Of all the people that God could call, he's choosing Abram, and there's no reason for it. There's no justification for it. The third thing that we see about Abram, and this is not a moral issue. These first two issues have been moral issues, right? The idolatry is a moral issue. That's a sin issue. This imperfect obedience, that's a moral issue. That's a sin issue. But the third issue that occurs that makes Abram an unlikely person for this promise is that Abram has no children. Abram has no children. Think about what this promise is saying. You're going to be a great nation. How does that happen without any children? Right? You can imagine, you can very well imagine Abram at this point in time getting told that, going, okay. Okie dokes. Right? Because it's obvious this is not taking place here. It's even been mentioned just tersely. If you look back in chapter 11, verse 30, it seems kind of off the cuff and just terse, but it's out there. Sarah was barren and had no child. You think of all the things that the writer could have chosen to write at this point in time, and he zeroes in on the fact he's got no children. There is no one that Abraham has as a seed at this point in time. And yet God is looking at Abraham and saying, I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to prosper you. Your descendants are going to be great in some capacity. This would have been unlikely for Abram. This likely is why you see in verse 4, this is likely why you see Lot going with Abraham. Lot is the son of Abram's brother Haran, who had already died. And you kind of can see that as Haran has died, different of his children have been kind of taken care of in different ways. One of them gets married to the other brother, which is strange, but this is a different point in time, right? And then you have Lot over here, which seems to have kind of been kind of maybe pseudo-adopted by Abraham. Abraham certainly has him under his wings, if not has adopted him outright in some capacity. And this likely is why Lot is tailing around with Abram at this point in time. Lot is probably presumed to be Abram's heir. He is presumed to be the one that is going to carry on after Abram is gone. But Lot's not really Abram's seed, is he? It's his brother's seed. It's his nephew. This is an unlikely situation for Abram to be into. And yet again, of all the people that God could have chosen on the face of the earth to give this promise, he chooses Abram, right? And this is why I choose the word election here that is taking place here. None of this was Abram's doing. None of this was something that Abram was worthy of in any sense whatsoever. Everything that is going on here is something that is an act of grace. Right? It is God looking at Abraham and saying, I am going to do something gracious to you. I am going to do something merciful for you. Abraham does respond in faith, though. Right? The obedience has been imperfect to this point. The obedience started in Ur. It took him to Haran, an imperfect obedience. But finally, we see Abram in verse 4. We finally see him going from Haran into the land of Canaan. He finally has reached the point where he believes. He is acting, and then he's acting out of this obedience. And he enters the land of Canaan. He brings Lot, who is probably his presumed heir. He brings his wife. He brings all of his possessions, which he has acquired in the land of Canaan. And he begins to move through the land of Canaan. As you watch this progression through the land of Canaan, he's basically going through the entire length of this land. He's going to start at the very top. He's going to make his way down to Shechem. He's going to make his way down to between the area between Bethel and Ai. And then finally, he's going to end up down the southern part, the Negev. And that's where eventually Judah and Simeon would have their land assigned to them there. He basically passes through the entire land. And as he passes through, most critically, his religion has changed. His worship has changed. You'll notice there that he makes it in verse 6. He passed through the land as far as the site of Shechem to the oak of Moreh. Now, what kind of oak must this be, right? We have an oak of Moreh. What a wonderful place to be. Well, no, this is not good, right? These kind of places, this kind of a tree would have been probably one of the tallest trees that's around. Right? It's either an oak or a terebinth. And if you choose an oak, there's a couple of varieties of that you can choose. Right? This tree would have been significant. Right? This would have been a large tree. Moreh seems to indicate something that is an oracle. So what you have here is this is a Canaanite center of worship. Right? This is a place where Canaanites were coming, and they were conducting their worship. They were worshiping the tree. They were worshiping deities related to the tree. This is where they are gathering. And Abram, the idolater, is there. But what is Abram doing? After God appears to him, end of verse 7, so he built there an altar. So he built an altar there to the Lord who appeared to him. Is he worshiping Canaanite deities? Is he worshiping whoever it is he worshiped back in Ur? No, he's worshiping the Lord. Right? Something has changed in Abram. Something has happened inside of his heart. He's no longer worshiping what he used to worship. He is now worshiping God. He continues to move down, and when he, as soon as we find him in verse 8, he proceeds from there to the mountain on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. This again would have been another holy site. This was an area that is considered holy. Bethel is also called Luz, which is an area where you see later Jacob setting up a pillar there as he's moving in and out of this area. But Abram is here again, and what does he do at this holy site? Is he worshiping Canaanite deities? Is he worshiping the gods that he worshiped in Ur? No, what's he doing? He's building an altar to the Lord, and he called upon the name of the Lord. Something in Abram has changed. Abram has gone from being an idolater to someone who is worshiping the Lord God. Abram has gone from someone who is imperfect in his obedience, right? He's kind of leaving things where he's supposed to go, but he's not leaving all of his family. So now he's left his family and he's finally made it to the land that God has shown it to him. Something has changed in Abram, right? This election that God has done, right? This work that God has done in Abram's life is producing results. There are good things that you are seeing out of Abram. And I think this is important because this mirrors the experience that you and I have as believers today. Right? The same thing is taking place. God is choosing believers. He is drawing people to himself. And those people aren't worthy of that. Those people don't deserve that. They're in their sins. Whatever that may look like, they're in their sins. They're worshiping something else. Maybe it's themselves. Maybe it's some other thing that's in their life. But God chooses them in the middle of those things, and he pulls them to himself. And then he begins to do a work. Right? Then he begins to change their heart. Then he begins to change their mind. And finally, we begin to see actions that spring forth from that. Actions that reflect that this faith is, in fact, alive. Right, there is something significant that has happened in our hearts, in our lives, in our minds. And Abram is as good an example of that as anyone else is. Someone who is unworthy, someone who is steeped in idolatry, steeped in his sin, now worshiping Jehovah in the land where he is meant to be. Abram has progressed. Abram has grown, and God has been the one who has done this to him. But we're not done in chapter 12. Right, chapter 12 is a roller coaster. Right, you come to the end of verse 9 and you're feeling pretty good about Abram, aren't you? I mean, look at this guy. This guy has the promises of God. This is a wonderful thing. This guy has made it from Ur to the land of Canaan. He is now where he is supposed to be. He is worshiping who he is supposed to be worshiping. This is good. We're doing okay. And then we take a nosedive here. Verse 10. Now there was a famine in the land. So Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. And it came about when he came near to Egypt that he said to Sarah, his wife, "See now, I know that you are a beautiful woman. And when the Egyptians say to you, they will say, the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife,' and they will kill me, but they will let you live. Please say that you are my sister, so that it may go well with me because of you, and that I may live on account of you." And it came about when Abram came into Egypt, the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. Pharaoh's officials saw her and praised her to Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. Therefore he treated Abram well for her sake, and he gave him sheep, oxen and donkeys, and male and female servants, and female donkeys and camels. But the Lord struck Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abram's wife. Then Pharaoh called Abram and said, "What is this you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister so that I took her from my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go." Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they escorted him away with his wife and all that belonged to him. This is where you begin to see the faithfulness of God, don't you? And the faithfulness of God in spite of a man who's got flaws and who's got some odd ideas of what it takes to stay alive. Okay? Anyone else, if you were to talk to the person and you were to hear this story recounted, said, "By the way, this is what I did over the weekend." Man, you're a jerk. You know, I mean, you just wouldn't have a lot of good things to say about Abram as this thing goes on, right? Now, Abram is in the land, and suddenly a famine arises, okay? And this is what Abram decides to do is not something that we'll see repeated several times throughout the life of the patriarchs, and it's something that would have been common historically in this area. Egypt has the Nile River. Egypt has that perpetual source of water, and they are a breadbasket. Right, they are growing crops, and there's not a lot that's going to disturb that activity. Canaan is another situation entirely. Canaan is dependent on how much rain comes in for that particular year. And so there are official records, there are historical records indicating that Abram would not have been the only person at this point in time that would have been doing this. Other individuals were going down to Egypt when things got tough, staying down there, planting their tents for a little bit, then making their way back to Canaan when things began to get better. The situation here with Abram is a little bit different now, isn't it? Because Abram's not like everyone else in this area. Abram's been given a promise. What was he promised? He was promised this land. What else was he promised? He was promised to be blessed. Right? He was promised to have his needs taken care of. He's going to prosper. He's going to survive. He's going to thrive in this way. Is he going to die? He's promised to become a great nation. Right, you think about the fears that Abram would have been experiencing, and those are natural fears, right? There's nothing unusual about Abraham thinking these things. But the problem is you counteract those with what the promises of God were, and it doesn't really make a lot of sense for Abram to be doing what he's doing. And as you watch the situation unfold, it seems pretty clear that Abram should never have been down here to begin with. And there's no sense in which we get from the text that God told Abram to go down to this area, right? Abram seems to have made this decision on his own thinking, on his own planning, and it seems to come out of unbelief. Whatever we thought about Abram at the end of verse 9, right, we find that there's still some struggles going on, aren't there? Right? He does believe. He is obeying. He's on the right path, but he's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. And this entire incident really comes and confirms this. As Abram goes down into Egypt, he's afraid not only for his own life in terms of being able to live and to eat and survive, but he's afraid as he goes down into Egypt that he might face death there on account of Sarah. Now, Abram, we saw back in verse 4, is 75. Abram is 75 years old. Sarah is probably around upper 60s at this point in time, and apparently is still quite a looker. I mean, really. I mean, because Abram is afraid of this from the beginning, and Abram's fears are not ill-founded, because what happens? Exactly what Abram fears is exactly what takes place. She catches the eye of everyone that's there, and they tell Pharaoh, "Have you seen this woman that came down from Canaan? Good-looking woman. Good-looking woman, you should look into this, right?" And this is exactly what happens. Abram's afraid of this, though, and he makes this plan with Sarah, and it just seems harebrained from every possible angle. It just seems harebrained that this plan would work. The plan is for Sarah to answer to anyone that comes down that Abram is my brother. Now, this is not entirely a lie. Sarah is, in fact, Abram's brother. We find this out in Genesis chapter 20 when Abram does this the second time he makes this decision. Sarah is actually Abram's sister, okay? She is a sister from another mother, but it's still the same father here, right? So there is a shred of truth that's going on here, but Sarah is most definitely Abram's wife, okay? And so this is a deception of the highest order, right? And this makes no sense. It makes no sense from any perspective. Even if she is the brother and Abram's plan is to just kind of keep saying, no, I can't give it to her, what stops him from killing him? There's nothing that stops anyone from killing Abraham at any point in this journey if they simply want Sarah and want them all to herself. And so this is a harebrained scheme, but they go along with it. And Sarah also goes along with it, right? Because she ends up in the situation where she ends up in, which means she had to have played the part. And so they play this part, and Sarah is brought in to Pharaoh's house. She is brought into Pharaoh's harem, right? She is made a wife of Pharaoh here. Abram comes out well for this. You see back in verse 16, right? Therefore, he treated Abram well for her sake. All right, Pharaoh is just heaping all of this stuff upon Abram because this is her brother, right? And he really wants Sarah. He really wants to this relationship to prosper and to thrive. And so he treats Abram very well. Meanwhile, Sarah is sitting inside the harem, right? And so this seems lopsided at best in terms of who's getting the better end of this deal. Abraham is certainly coming out far better than Sarah is. Verse 17, disaster strikes. So not only do we have the famine already a disaster, but we have another disaster. Verse 17, the Lord struck Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abram's wife. Then Pharaoh called Abram and said, what is this you have done to me? What is this you have done to me? What a great question to have asked. What did you do to me? Right? This is an awful situation. There is nothing in the text that demands that Pharaoh did actually sleep with Sarah. There's nothing in the text that demands it. But based on the fact that plagues break out on Pharaoh and his house, and the second time we don't have that situation, the second time when we get to Genesis chapter 20, there's a vision that comes to Abimelech where God says, I kept you from her. I didn't let this happen. There seems to be an indication that there is some kind of relationship that occurs between Pharaoh and Sarah at this point in time. And this is what warrants the plagues, right? This is what causes the plagues. Pharaoh has transgressed, and he's transgressed badly. But what's Pharaoh's problem? He has no idea. He has no idea what he's done. Why does he not know? Because Abram and Sarah are over here lying about the situation, right? And so plagues break out on Pharaoh, break out on his household. Pharaoh apparently is able to determine why this has taken place. Why are these curses coming on me? Why are these plagues coming upon me? And the answer comes up, it's Abram and it's Sarah. This is the source of your problem. As you look at the way that Pharaoh kind of shuffles them out of Egypt, right? He escorts them out of Egypt. It seems to imply that not only does Pharaoh know that these two are the cause, but he also knows he better not lay a hand on them. You can very well imagine if it had been anyone else, if it had been any other situation, and these two had caused these kind of plagues, after Pharaoh had given them all this stuff, it would have been off with their heads. And so there is every indication that however it is that Pharaoh found out about this, God was behind that. God was making sure not only that Sarah got out of that situation, but God was also making sure that Abram and Sarah made it out with their very own lives, and with addition with the rest of the stuff that Abram's just gotten from Pharaoh's hand here. Right? And so they are escorted out. And this is a low point, is it not? Here is Abram. He looks like he's doing so well, and yet we find him coming down and just doing harebrained things, right? Putting Sarah in a situation that is utterly unfair to her. Right? She did nothing to get herself in this situation, and she is the one who is bearing the greater brunt of the situation than Abram is. This is an awful situation. And I would pose that there's two applications for us at this point in time. Number one is that despite the selfishness and unbelief of Abraham, God remains faithful to him. God could have rather justly let Abraham just pay for his own sin down there in Egypt. That would have been a pretty natural ending to that story, right? And thus ended Abram's life, right? He's gone. He's moved. I'll go find someone else. I'll go give someone else some promises because Abram apparently is a bonehead and can't figure out what's going on, right? That would have been a natural result. Does God do that? No, because God made a promise to him. And God intended for that promise to be kept, and God intended for that promise to succeed. Though Abram is there in unbelief, though Abram is sinning, though Abram is acting foolishly and dangerously with his life and with the life of Sarah as well, yet God is remaining faithful to him. And you see this by the fact that God brings them back out of Egypt alive, prospered, blessed in a certain sense, in the sense that they come out with more than they went in with here. God is faithful to them despite of all of Abram's failings and all of Abram's shortcomings at this point in time. And Sarah as well, right? She's the one continuing the charade. The second point of application that I think we need to note is that Abram also serves as a good illustration of what it means to grow in our faith. What does it mean to grow in faith? Once I become a child of God, once I become a believer, and I believe, right? I have heard the message of the gospel. I have heard what it is that Christ has done with me, and I am changed. I have a new heart that has been given to me. The Spirit is in me. What does that mean that my life will look like? Does it mean that I will never sin again? Does it mean that my obedience from this point out will be perfect in all as far as it could possibly go? And you look at the life of Abraham, and I think you see a better picture of what life will look like, right? Is Abram progressing? And the answer is yes. Look where he was in Ur. Look what he was doing in Ur. Look what he was obeying and who he was serving in Ur. And look at him now. Right, he knows who the Lord God is now. Right, he understands what true worship looks like. He understands what obedience looks like. But does that make Abram perfectly obedient? The answer is no. Right, he is still capable of failing and failing spectacularly. Right, and I think it's a good warning. It's a good lesson to us. Many times we as believers we get saddled. We get saddled with depression. We get saddled with guilt because of our failings. We look in and we say, well, look at me. I mean, I've fallen again this week. I'm not making any progress in any discernible way. I mean, I failed last week. I failed this week. Chances are really good I'm going to fail the next week after that. And that's not what is meant to be focused on in those situations. Does there need to be repentance in those times? Absolutely. Do those need to be viewed as opportunities for growth? Absolutely. Do we learn from those times? Yes. But does that mean that we are not believers? Does that mean that God will toss us away and throw us out? No. Look at Abram. Look how God deals with Abram. Even in the middle of Abraham's foolishness, I would even say his stupidity, even in the middle of that, God brings him up and carries him right back out of Egypt, puts him right back down in Canaan and says, let's start this over again. Right? And there is something to be learned from that. There is something to be reflected on with that. God is a God who is faithful, and he is a God who is merciful, and he is a God who is gracious. And you see this abundantly displayed in Abram's life, right? What is Abram if not a display of God's grace? What is Abram if not a display of God's mercy and God's faithfulness? And the God of Abram is our God, right? And we need to know that. We need to remember that. We can take hope and we can take encouragement from what we see in Abraham, a man who fails and yet is growing, a man who is flawed, and yet God has elected him and chosen him when anyone else could have been chosen on the face of the earth, right? He is the one who has received the promises. He is the beneficiary of the faithfulness of God. In Christ, we have far more. In Christ, there is far more for us to look at. And it should be a source of encouragement and a source of hope for us as we go throughout our lives. We need to remember that. We have to keep that in mind, okay? Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for what we see in Abram. Father, this is a man that we can relate to in many ways. We can look at the success that he experiences in those first few verses, and we understand what that looks like. We know what it feels like to feel like we're doing well, like we're growing, like we're succeeding in the Christian life and prospering and thriving. But then, Father, we also know what it looks like to be on that second part of the chapter. Father, when we're hanging our head in shame. When we know that we failed, we know that we have made a mistake yet again, Father. We have sinned against you in some way. We have acted in unbelief. Father, we know what both of those feelings look like. And I thank you, Father, that our relationship with you does not depend on those feelings. It does not depend on that whatsoever. It depends on your faithfulness. that covenant that you have made with us in Christ. And so, Father, I pray that we learn from Abram, a man who is tested the same way as we are, who is tried the same way we are, who is cut out of the same cloth. And Father, I pray that we learn from him. I pray that we grow from seeing his example, and I pray that we take encouragement and hope, Father, from your faithfulness as we see you and the way that you express yourself with Abram. So give us grace, Father, to do this, to love you more, to grow more in our faith, and to live lives that are obedient and glorifying to you. Give us grace, Father, for this. Just then I pray. Amen.